Hey guys, Scott here, and welcome to the Ultimate Oni Guide. I have been obsessed with this thick boy since day one of the test servers, and I love him just as much as I loved Huntress, so I thought I would make a guide on him. I waited a decent amount of time to make this guide because, as with any guide I make, I want to make sure I know what I'm talking about. That being said, without any further delay, I think Oni is one of the strongest killers in the game if played well, and hopefully this guide can show you how. If I had an intro transition, it would go here. Let's start with the basics. Oni's power is called Blood Fury. Once he absorbs enough blood, he can enter a rage that gives him two new abilities temporarily. The first is Demon Strike, which basically just means that any lunge attack you do during Blood Fury goes further and down survivors one hit. And the other is Demon Rush, which massively increases his speed as long as the power is being held. Demon Rush can be changed into Demon Strike, allowing you to down survivors in almost any situation very rapidly. While Blood Fury is arguably the strongest power in the game, it also requires buildup in the sense you must absorb blood from injured survivors, which means you must make them injured in the first place. Considering you are powerless until you get blood, the beginning of the match is by far the worst time to be the Oni. When you down a survivor in Blood Fury as well, you lose a small portion of your power, unless you have add-ons to circumvent it. Additionally, your power completely deactivates when picking up a survivor. However, none of your progress towards getting your power again is lost. This kind of pushes the Oni into a very slug-heavy playstyle, and if you're not a fan of slugging, I can safely say this is not the killer for you. Playing Oni without slugging is extremely inefficient and you will struggle immensely against good teams. Now, as far as builds go, I've tinkered with a bunch of different setups, but I found the most success with this exact perk selection. In order of importance, Infectious Fright is non-negotiable. This perk makes all survivors in the killer's Terror Radius scream when a survivor is downed. This is the perk that lets Oni snowball rapidly if survivors are even remotely nearby. I can't think of a single better perk for this killer. Next, Barbecue and Chili is kind of like a staple on any killer, but it also works really well for Oni's early game. The usual startup to any match I have consists of hitting a survivor, chasing until I have enough blood to use my power, downing the survivor, hooking him, and then using Barbecue and Chili in combination with my power to rapidly down other survivors. Plus, I mean like double blood points, come on. Next would be Monitor and Abuse, which again, it just works so well with Oni in multiple ways, I wouldn't even remove this perk. This perk basically makes your Terror Radius 8 meters wider while in a chase and reduces it by 8 meters when not in a chase. The reduced Terror Radius combined with the Oni's strangely quiet Terror Radius music allows you to get surprisingly close to survivors to get that ever important first hit. When in a chase, the increased Terror Radius synergizes with Infectious Fright to reveal all survivors in a 40 meter range, which depending on your location can literally be like a third of the entire map. Monitor and Abuse is one of those perks you need to watch a VOD of a streamer you go against to see how useful this smaller Terror Radius actually is. You would be surprised how easy it is to sneak up on people with a combination of this perk and the Oni's more quiet music. Now, the last perk is really anything you want, but it should be a game delay perk in some way. Corrupt Intervention works great due to it synergizing with the fact Oni has a weak early game. Pop Goes the Weasel is better for mid and late game and often results in more time loss for the survivors than Corrupt Intervention, but it's also more inconsistent. Sloppy Butcher is another interesting delay perk I experimented with. It basically forces survivors to either heal more slowly, which delays the game, or choose to not heal at all, which gives you your power more frequently because they're staying injured longer, which means more blood is being dropped. I've mostly been using Pop Goes the Weasel, but really any of these perks will work just fine. Now, the Oni has mostly very good add-ons. Ironically, his iridescent add-ons are by far his weakest, bordering on actually detrimental to even equip. It's actually bad to have some of them. Why this is the case, I have no idea, but it is what it is. Now, luckily, almost every other add-on the Oni has is great. The strongest add-on he has is the Scalped Topknot, which, no joke, doubles the speed at which you charge your Demon Dash. It is insanely strong and leagues above his other add-ons, in my opinion. The next most powerful would be any duration-increasing add-ons. These add-ons have multiple benefits as they simply increase the duration of Blood Fury, but also technically reduce the penalty you get for downing survivors due to making the overall time you have longer. Again though, other than maybe the passive recharge add-ons, you can't go wrong with any of these choices. Oni is one of the few killers in the game who is really not add-on dependent at all. He can do just fine with nothing equipped, which is honestly great. Additionally, those duration add-ons extend the amount of time you have to snowball a match and end it very quickly, so they're extremely good. Now, let's finally talk about how to actually play the game as Oni. I always like making this part in the structure of how an actual game is played out because it's almost like a checklist of things to do in order to progress the match correctly. So, step one, find and hit somebody. There's nothing more to say here. This is the worst part of the game for Oni. you know, you shouldn't be surprised if you lose a gen or two just trying to hit a guy for the first time. This is normal, and you shouldn't really panic yet. Monitor and Abuse will get you that first hit much quicker than you would think. You can get closer. Just so long as you have good map knowledge of where survivors will actually spawn, you can get your first hit in under a minute most of the time. Hitting a healthy survivor gives you about 40% of your power and makes them begin dropping blood orbs, each of which grant about 2 to 3% of your power individually. Step 2 is basically farm the now injured survivors for blood. This is called the ooh, a piece of candy phase. You don't actually want to down the survivor until you're at about 94% of your power, because when you hook a survivor, they drop 3 more blood orbs, which will complete it. Instead, just follow the survivor and keep absorbing their blood. Forcing the survivor to vault or drop pallets makes them drop significantly more blood, so keep that in mind while trying to fill your power as quickly as possible. Now, if you can down the survivor with your power fill, that's great. If not, it's still not a big deal, because now you have the strongest power in the game, and 3 other survivors that will have very little time to prepare. Ideally, you would down the first survivor, hook them, see other survivors with barbecue and chili, use your power to get there, but in the worst case scenario, you just let the injured survivor go and find someone else with your power. Thing is, you don't want to just randomly use your power, you want to use it when you have an idea of where another survivor will be. This makes it so the survivor can't hide in time, as a lot of survivors will go into hiding when they hear the map-wide scream as you activate Blood Fury, because the power, like I said, is terrifying. An extremely important thing to note when you're playing Oni is you need to have good memory. Leaving survivors that are injured like this means you're creating a pool of blood somewhere, so remembering where you saw that survivor last, or maybe a generator they were working on, is vital to restoring your power as quickly as possible. You have to create a mental map in your head of where injured survivors were, which isn't that hard considering they leave giant red blood orbs everywhere. Anyway, now you see another survivor, and then you use your power. As soon as you activate it, they should be dead in the next 20 seconds, if you play it correctly, with very few exceptions. This is why the Oni is so terrifying when played well. It's almost impossible to actually get away from him when his power is up, although certain tiles do render the power kinda weak. In a few minutes, I'll get into how to actually use Demon Dash correctly, but I still want to go over the flow of the game first. So, you down this new survivor and immediately look around for Infectious Fright. If you see someone, great, hunt them down and kill them. In this scenario, I saw someone, but I have no idea how I lost this magician, so I just cut my losses and went back to pick up the survivor. Thing is, you need to never waste more of your power than you need to. You can't afford to just look around with your power active. So sometimes cutting your losses and just picking up the survivor is the correct choice. Even in this scenario, you should still have a large amount of your power already charged, at which point the memory kicks in. Where was the survivor I originally injured? I head back in that direction and find a large pool of blood nearby, which guarantees I'll have my power again soon. Usually, with enough time, this is enough to just straight up get your power, but in this case, it was just a little bit short. The thing is, the overall goal is to push survivors into a smaller area, because, you know, be it because there's like someone they have to unhook, or because there's gens nearby, or whatever. If you get even 2 survivors within 40 meters of you, you can rapidly end the game by chaining downs together with Infectious Fright. This is why the Oni, and frankly every killer in Dead by Daylight, can struggle with very large maps like Rotten Fields or Red Forest. However, on any reasonably sized map, snowballing with Infectious Fright is how you win almost every single game with Oni. Well, let's actually talk about the good stuff now. Demon Dash. This power is insanely fun to use for me. With Blood Fury active, using your power button will charge Demon Dash, during which you move a bit slower but kind of the same speed as the survivor. Once the bar is filled, you begin moving extremely fast and lose the ability to turn freely. However, you can strafe left and right, which is key to steering the Oni correctly. Now the first tip, do not hold forward while using Demon Dash. This gives a negligible speed increase and actually drastically slows your strafing speed left and right down. There's almost no situation where you would want to hold forward while using Demon Dash. Additionally, you can actually slow yourself down in Demon Dash by repeatedly mashing left and right. Doing so correctly almost halves your forward speed, which is great because sometimes you need to begin turning, or maybe you're anticipating something like a dead heart. A great feature of Demon Dash is running into walls does not cancel your power at all. In fact, you can wall strafe to great effect, which is something I'll cover in kind of the advanced section of this guide. Now, at any point during Demon Dash, you can use your primary attack button to transition into a Demon Strike. Now, as a side note, you can use Demon Strike without Demon Dash by simply just holding your attack button for at least half a second. You can tell because the animation will change and you'll bring up the giant club in front of you. As long as you're in Blood Fury, this will one-shot. When you Demon Strike out of a Demon Dash, you can actually turn 90 degrees during the lunge. This is what makes the Oni such a devastating killer. As long as you can get close enough to a survivor, even if they round a corner, you can still flick 90 degrees around that corner and hit them. Now, I wish there was a simple way to explain when you can use Demon Dash in tiles like Jungle Gyms, but there really isn't. It's sort of a thing you just have to kind of feel out and judge based on your distance to the survivor in relation to where they are in the tile. There is no way I can make a guide that shows every single situation where a Demon Dash can down someone, but I will say you can definitely do it at like regular Jungle Gyms and like the Shack, for example. I think it's better to say where you can't effectively Demon Dash, and that's at things like very short loops and LT walls. The thing is, LT walls have a 180 degree turn at their edges, which you just can't rotate towards, so it's best playing these relatively weak tiles normally and just hitting a normal Demon Strike. Feel free to look at my tiles guide to learn how to just play these tiles normally, but that's a good example of when Demon Dash doesn't actually work super well. Whenever you have to make multiple turns in a very short radius, then it's not that great. Still, even on short loops though, there is an effective strategy, which is pretending to enter one way and rapidly strafing to the other. If done correctly, the survivor won't have time to adjust their direction, and you can still flick 90 degrees at the very end to just barely clip them. The thing is, while you're learning, don't be afraid to try dashing at every single setup. The cooldown for canceling the power is extremely small and forgiving, and there's no way to learn other than trying repeatedly. Again, I wish there was a way I could show you exactly via some like math formula the exact distance between you and the survivor and when you start the power to be able to successfully actually Demon Dash, but there are just so many little variables, and it's really something you just have to feel out. Another solid piece of advice is learning to charge your power in such a way that you are rounding a corner right as the dash begins. This allows you to dash straight for as long as possible and cover the most distance. Whenever possible, try saving your charge for the greatest straight line and have it activate just the second you round the corner to have access to that straight line. Next, let's go over a few things I would consider a bit more advanced. These tactics involve intentionally running into walls and wall strafing. For example, here I see a survivor on the other side of the shack. I start charging in, but then change my direction and just straight up run into this wall on purpose. Because I am now out of her line of sight, it makes her think I'm now dashing around the other side of the shack as I have not actually canceled my dash yet. However, after a brief pause, I come right back to where I was. This hesitation is all you need, and it's enough to guarantee a down seconds later. It's incredible how panicked survivors become when they hear you dashing but suddenly cannot put two and two together of where you actually are. Running into walls intentionally lets you abuse this to great effect. Additionally, running into a wall lets you slowly readjust your turn without actually canceling your dash. This is effective in a lot of situations, and a great example is wall strafing. This is probably the hardest thing to learn with Oni, but it's extremely strong, albeit a bit situational. Wall strafing is basically when you chase a survivor, except you are moving sideways to chase them against the wall, and you're listening for their position instead of actually seeing them. This allows you to continue chasing survivors despite the fact they took a turn you could not possibly adjust for. For example, I start dashing and know the Fang is on the other side of this wall. However, that's way too sharp of a turn, I can't make that. My options are to cancel my power and then keep chasing, or strafe against this wall and listen to her position. When I hear she's close enough or when I collide with her, I immediately unattach from the wall and flick towards where she is, saving me a huge amount of time in the chase. Blindly chasing like this allows you to take turns by strafing without actually looking at where you're going. It does rely on extensive map knowledge as you have to know what's out of your field of vision at all times, but if done properly, it makes almost any tileable actually playable with Demon Dash. Like I said though, it's really hard to describe like every situation and the appropriate action for it, so I think now I'm going to do a gameplay review on a game I just recorded a minute ago for this, and I feel like that's kind of a good way to address a lot of these situations as they happen naturally, so let's go to that. Alright, so let's go to the unscripted portion of this, where basically I'm just going to watch one of my own games and then just kind of go over every little thing that I did. And I think, because you know, like I said, it's so hard to address every single little situation, so I think just looking at an actual game, I can give better examples of the things that I'm talking about as well. So, start Blood Lodge, already not a great map monitor to abuse, doesn't get much use because they can kind of see you coming. However, luckily they were in an area where I could sneak up on them, so this is just general killer knowledge going to where you think they'll spawn. I go over here, and luckily they're right here now. Already, this is a great example of how strong monitor and abuse is. One guy started running, but for the most part, like, look how close I am before people start running away. Like, I'm within, like, 6 meters of these people. And it's not because they're blind or dumb or anything like that. It's because you really need to hear monitor and abuse with Oni on the, like, from the other side, from the survivor side. But it is so quiet. That's why I think monitor is such a good perk on him. But it lets me get a first hit very, very easily, which is great. And then we enter the OOP Candy phase, where I'm just gonna just suck her blood up. I have no intentions of downing her, even if I downed her right now. That guy's moonwalking like a boss. I gotta nod to that. But yeah, at this point, I'm just trying to farm blood. Her dropping the pallet's great. She drops double blood orbs when she drops a pallet or vaults. So every time she does that, she's gonna drop more, which is very good for me. And so we're gonna keep chasing until I get my power, and that's pretty much it. I have no intention of downing this person. I see that the Nia to the left just started running away because she knew exactly what was happening. So she smartly was like, all right, I'm gonna get the fuck out of here. And she already starts running, but Oni doesn't give a shit. At this point, I want to leave her injured because this is a generator right here. This is why leaving people is not even a bad idea. So this is a gen right here. I know if she's injured, either she's going to sit here and heal, which means there's going to be a bunch of blood here, or she's going to go on this generator and start working on it, which means, again, there's going to be a bunch of blood somewhere later for me. So I remember this location, activate my power, see this guy, and now I can just go chase this guy. And this guy should be a pretty easy down because, you know, again, you have so little time to prepare. And so I just go cruising in. He almost makes it to a pallet. He won't be able to do it. And he goes down. So now I'm going to pick this guy up immediately because no one was on Infectious Fright. And now I still, you know, I saved, you know, almost 65% of my power. I still have a bunch of my power left. So all I got to do is hook this guy and barbecue and chili to see where other people are. Probably the first thing I'm going to do, though, is go back to that area where I injured the first survivor and look for her blood, because I can guarantee she's been working on that generator now. And there's going to be a bunch of blood there to get my power again. Like I said, don't be worried if you lose one or two gens very quickly. It happens. This is just how Oni works. He's got no early game potential. He's all mid and late game. So losing two gens, not a big deal. Like I said, here she is. And here's all that blood. So no matter what, there was going to be blood here. Now, her other option was to run into a corner of the map and heal and then come back. But then she would have wasted all of this time not working on the gen. So while it is a thing a survivor can do to not make me find their blood, it also delays the game immensely too, so it still works out. That being said, get my power back already because we didn't use much of it. I use Pop Goes the Weasel here, and now I know she's going to continue bleeding in that corner, so I don't care about her. That guy just finished a gen, and then I believe this gen is about to pop too, so I go check that one out. So yeah, like I said, two gens gone, only one hook. This is not at all uncommon. I'm never really panicked in this situation. Other guy got saved, and my only option here is to chase this guy. And this is where the example of running into the wall worked. Go here, and then I'm just going to kind of stop. Make her think I'm going around that side, come back here, and then I'm going to strafe around and flick to the right. And she goes down pretty fast. Again, I pick up immediately. I'm about 65% power. So I find that injured survivor again. Again, I get my power back immediately. So you can see how leaving people injured is great because you just can get your power back. People say like, oh, it's Billy with like a power that, you know, you only get every couple minutes. In my games, I usually have my power like every 20 seconds. Like it's much faster than you think as long as you leave one survivor injured. And even if they don't stay injured, they've left blood somewhere while they were healing or being healed. So it's still good. It still delays the game because now they're healing and they're not doing gens. So no matter what, it's still good. And they might not even have self-care. They might not even have a medkit. They might have no choice. So again, I'm going to leave the injured survivor. She's still bleeding. I have no interest in doing anything to her. I'd rather find an injured survivor and just straight up down them. So I know she's going to go back in that gen probably and continue leaving blood orbs for me to get my power again. Here I do the whole wall strafing thing to down Fang really quickly. And I've been getting pretty unlucky with Infectious Fright here. I got to say, every single time I've downed somebody, there's been no one on Infectious Fright. Blood Lodge is just a big map, and it's hard to kind of snowball with it, but you're not going to get an Infectious Fright snowball every time you down someone. However, it's not a big deal, because as soon as you pick them up, you know, you would still have 65% of your power, so it's not a big deal. That being said, I know that Fang is working on that gen, so I go back, because I don't need Infectious Fright, I know where she is already. So, there, it looks like a scenario where you might try to lunge, but I don't know, like, I just know... Like, this is a 90 degree turn, and then this is a 90 degree turn. Old Oni could have done this. New Oni can't do that, so I just cancel my power instead. Which is not a big deal, because, you know, I just downed her a couple seconds later. It's unsatisfying not hitting them with the Demon Dash portion of it. And there it is. So now I know where everybody is. One guy is slugged, one guy's on the hook. At this point, I pretty much win. I have my power up. I can still definitely down one person. Oh, wait, no, there's only one guy left. Never mind. Yeah, so we know where the last guy is, and, you know, it's Oni. So the chance of getting away is pretty slim. His only option here was to jump down, which he does, so I can't immediately hit him. But it, it doesn't matter. Like, the cooldown is so low, and then I just down him anyway. And then that's it. That's the whole game. Ended in 3 minutes and 30 seconds. So that's just a perfect example of how incredibly fast Oni can snowball, and why you should not be scared if you know, you shouldn't be scared if people do gens very fast before you even get your power. It's not a big deal. Oni is the king of snowballing. He is terrifying at snowballing, so don't really panic when that happens. It's not a big deal. And you just gotta, you know, maintain focus and remember that he can end the game just as fast as they can. And like I said, I got no use out of Infectious Fright until the very end, but that's all I needed. You just need one successful Infectious Fright with your power up, and then that's a game. Like, as long as you can use your power correctly, it's so hard to get away from him, and then you just chain downs, and then it's just over, just like that. So, hopefully that was a decent example of how a normal game progression would go. An example of how fast he is, and none of these survivors really made any huge mistakes, except at the beginning, where they didn't run away. But again, that's because my Tyranidas was so very quiet, and it's not even like that they're bad, it's just it makes so little sound. So, no one really made any huge mistakes here, it just, that's just an example of why Oni is, so good at snowballing. And, yeah, that ends this for the non-scripted portion of the video. Finally, here's a couple of little things that I don't feel like fit in any section, but they're just still useful tips overall for Oni. The first would be, don't be afraid to use your power on injured people to start chaining things together. I see a lot of people, they like, there's an injured survivor running away, and they have their power up, but they kind of want to save it because he's already injured, and they don't want to, like, you know, waste the time spent getting the power again and all that. Pretty much almost every time I see a moving object and my power is up, I use my power. And it's not actually a bad thing, because as soon as you down that person, which will be much faster because you're using your power, the thing is, you're using that as a catalyst for Infectious Fright. So as soon as you down them, now you're chaining it together, probably to somebody that's full health, and you still have over half your power to go, at which point you would down them. So don't be afraid to use your power on injured people. If it's the only person you see in the area, it's not a big deal. You should pretty much be using your power at all times as long as you see somebody. On very short loops, while if you're in Blood Fury, it's just better to just chase them normally. You might end up wasting more time sliding all over the place, because the loop is so short you can't really turn around it fast enough. The thing is, though, loops that are this short, it doesn't matter, because they can only last like one loop anyway, so it's not even a big deal. Just run around it once and break it with your power. Oh, that is also another thing I forgot to mention. You can actually break pallets using your Demon Strike, so that's good to know. It is about the same speed as a Brutal Strike kick on a pallet, so it's still very good to do. So yeah, on small loops, just don't be afraid to not use your power at all. If you're in Blood Fury, don't use Demon Dash, just run around at once, break the pallet, and then when they're running to the next tile, that's when you close the gap and kill them. Finally, you can't Demon Strike while falling. This has gotten me to miss a couple of kills. As soon as you, even if you're in your lunge, the second you stop start actually falling, it cancels it. However, you can Demon Dash while you're falling. So if you still want to maintain, or you want to, like, you know, not let the survivor gain any more distance, like say you're on Haddonfield, they jump down from upstairs, you can Demon Dash off and still move forward and it won't cancel the Demon Dash. It's just the actual Demon Strike, the lunge, that is canceled. Overall though, I think that is mostly everything. Again, I wish I could be more specific with the examples. Like I thought of like recording like, you know, 50 attempts at, you know, somebody running Jungle Gems on me and showing exact examples of where it could use Demon Dash, but there's just so many little variables that it's like the guide would be 6 hours long and that's just impossible to do. So it's the kind of thing, just watch streamers that play Oni, try it yourself a bunch of times. It's definitely a killer you gotta feel out, but once you get that feel, it just feels so good, man. He's such a fun killer. He's so good. I think he's like right under Hillbilly in strength, and I hope you guys enjoy this guide and start slamming some people with some big fat sausages. That is some Gachi-based shit right there. All right, boys, take it easy. Have a good one. And if you have any questions that I missed, I will be happy to answer them in the comments. Thanks for watching and take it easy.